Paul says we have been set free. Paul states that we have been set free from the power of sin, that it's the power it exercises over us through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because we have accepted the free gift of salvation that Christ has offered to us, we are no longer under sin's control. We are free. Paul says that because we have made the conscious decision to accept the gift that Christ has offered to us, those temptations and the power of sin that once controlled us no longer exert the power over us that they once did. And the more closely we begin to follow Jesus, the more power we gain to overcome those temptations. But we still have a few temptations. One lady reminded me that age takes care, though, of a lot of those struggles that we often had in our youth. I remember several years ago, I was in our local grocery store doing some shopping, and I noticed that one of my church ladies was walking down the aisle. As she walked down the aisle, she seemed to be paying a lot of attention to a handsome young man who was also there in that same aisle. But he seemed not to notice her. When she saw that I was watching her, she blushed a little bit. And she looked at me and said with a sigh, "There was a day when his eyes would have been all over me as I walked by." I remember you preached on avoiding temptation last Sunday, didn't you? And then she got this faraway, distant look in her eyes and she said, "Don't worry about avoiding temptation. As you get older, it starts avoiding you." As we prepare to celebrate one of our nation's greatest holidays, the anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence, let's all of us just reflect for a moment on the subject of freedom. As Americans, we have the privilege of living in one of the freest societies on the planet. Our Constitution and our Bill of Rights outline and define for us the freedoms that being an American citizen affords us. So with that in mind, let me ask, what does it mean for us to be free? Does freedom mean that we're not under any rules? That we can just do whatever we please? Or rather, does it mean that we have an obligation to now live under a different set of rules because of the freedom that was won for us? French politician and author Alexis de Tocqueville visited America back in the 1850s to study the American political system and try to understand it. He wrote in his publication, Democracy in America, "The health of a democratic society may be measured by the quality of functions performed by private citizens, and also that liberty cannot be established without morality, nor morality without faith." Most Americans feel a great sense of duty to their country because we are free citizens and we enjoy those freedoms that were won for us. But the freedoms we enjoy as Americans were gained at a great price through several wars and other conflicts. Something our founding fathers knew is that freedom isn't free, and also that with freedom comes responsibility. It's true, Jesus has saved us from the power of sin, and we have been released from the power that sin once exercised over us. We are free. But now, what will we do with that freedom? A question that is often asked by new Christians is, now what? If they are a new convert, and they have recently come to faith in Jesus Christ, many will ask, okay, I'm a Christian. I accepted Christ, I'm free, and that's great, but now what? It's the now what that I would like us to think about today. What should our response be for the priceless gift of salvation and freedom that God has given to us? Jesus has saved us, we are no longer under sin's control, and we are free. Now, what should we do with it? Does this mean we are free to do whatever we please? Live however we want? And since we are under grace, we can just do whatever makes us happy, right? Well, Paul is very careful to address this question. And he asks, should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? And the answer, of course, is absolutely not. Paul carefully reminds his readers that freedom in Christ does not mean they are free to do whatever they please. There is no such thing as freedom that is devoid of responsibility or accountability. We still have an obligation to God and to other people. It is true that salvation is a free gift. It frees us from the bondage of sin, as Paul would say. However, the freedom that Christ has won for us comes with strings attached, with responsibilities. Paul carefully points this out. We have become free from the sin master, free from sin's power over us, which leads to death, but now we must answer to a new master, God, righteousness. Paul says, look what we've won through Christ. We now have salvation. We have been justified through our faith in Christ, and we have received the gift of eternal life. I'm often troubled by the fact that so many people in this country think that just because they're Americans, they do not have to answer to anyone. As long as they don't break any laws or hurt anyone, they are free to do whatever makes them happy. And they don't owe anyone anything. They believe that the only one they have to please is themselves. They seem to have no sense of duty to take on the responsibilities of good citizenship that must be present for a free society to work. They feel no obligation to all the patriots who have gone before, those who made such great sacrifices, so they could remain free and enjoy all the benefits of being an American citizen. However, most of us do understand and accept those responsibilities and the benefits of freedom. And with it, we also accept the duty that we have to our country and to our fellow Americans. Remember that when we accepted Christ, we became part of God's family and citizens of heaven. Therefore, we're part of a team. Now, most of us, I would bet the majority of us here love sports. We have our own sport. Most of you, don't you watch football, basketball, baseball? Don't you keep up with your favorite team? I see a lot of blue things many times with Royals written on them. We love our sports in America. So being part of a team is something that we, well, should easily understand. One of our greatest athletes once made the comment, there are two ways to enjoy sports in this country. You can participate and play them, or you can just watch others play them. Well, many of us do both. Most choose to simply be a spectator and watch. I believe that's kind of a shame, because those that just sit passively by and watch never reap the benefits that come through participation, being part of the team. But I guess they just choose to watch because it's easy, because it doesn't require any discipline, because it doesn't require any commitment to practice or to invest any time working toward getting better. They can just watch others play and enjoy the experience through them. However, being a disciple of Jesus Christ and participating truly as a disciple of Christ requires more than just sitting passively by and watching others do it. We must train and practice daily so that we might get better at living out our faith, so that we might become better at being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Spectator sports in this country have become one of the biggest revenue generators there are. We spend billions of dollars watching, following, attending games, and regurgitating sports trivia with our friends. We have been conditioned from an early childhood to be a spectator, to watch while others perform, as we sit in our living rooms watching countless games on our television sets. We have become much too satisfied, I think, with just being a spectator. We have become a spectator society, always waiting for someone else to play the game and entertain us. Unfortunately, this is the way that many in our society also practice their Christian faith. For many today, Christianity is just another spectator sport. Most Christians are all too happy to sit passively by and watch others do the worship, serve on the committees, work on a mission team, work to bring new people to faith in Jesus Christ. Because so many Christians have become satisfied with just being a spectator. They only come to church maybe once or twice a month, or some only a few times a year. They never invite others to come to church or anything else that requires more than just a very trivial investment of their time and money. The fact is that far too many Americans have become satisfied with just being spectators instead of being participants. We have become a spectator society. And many people have just become spectator Christians. Why has being just a spectator become so acceptable? Is being just a spectator faithful to what Christ taught? Do you believe this is what God had in mind when he called you to be one of his disciples? Think about this question and then answer truthfully. What if we put the same amount of effort into keeping up with our church's ministries and its performance as we do our favorite sports team? What if we put the same effort into remembering Scripture as we do remembering what player had the most home runs in 2015? Or which running back rushed for the most yards in 2016? What if we were willing to talk as much about God and our relationship with God with our friends and coworkers as much as we talk about them about our favorite baseball team? What if we care just as much about winning others for Christ and bringing new people into the fellowship of our church as we care about who makes it to the World Series or the Super Bowl? What if we were to quit just being spectator Christians and made a serious commitment to really get involved in making a difference through the mission and ministry of our church? It's true. We have been given a wonderful gift of freedom in Christ, as Paul says. But with that freedom comes responsibility, and you cannot have one without the other. What difference would it make in our church if we truly began to live out our faith and reached out to others in the way that Christ has asked us to do? One more question. When is the last time that you talked with someone about your faith? Outside of your family. And when was the last time you invited and actually brought someone with you to church? When is the last time you were in a Sunday school class or participated in a Bible study so that you could learn more about about your faith and how to be a more effective witness for Jesus Christ. When was the last time that you participated in one of your church's ministries or outreach programs or went on a mission trip, worked on a Habitat House, worked in the food pantry, and so on? What would happen in this church and in this community if most of our church members, especially those who are not active, remembered the vows that they took and lived up to them and quit being just a spectator Christian? What if we stopped waiting for someone else to do it and really put our full effort to being a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ? Let's pray. Loving God, guide us in our efforts. Remind us of who we are, what we have been given through your death and resurrection, and the bright future that we have ahead of us. Lord, help us to share this good news with others, so that others may also come to faith in Christ and become a part of our church family. We ask these things in